I want to describe a three-level model to help us organize our thinking about the different sorts of requirements information. There's a saying about models: all models are wrong, some models are useful. That premise applies here. This model is clearly a simplification, but I think it's useful and I hope you will also. Notice that this model does not imply a waterfall or sequential software development process. The same concepts apply in iterative and incremental development projects. The question is really a matter of whether you're specifying the requirements for the entire product or just for the next increment or release. At the top level are the business requirements. Business requirements are a kind of why information. They describe why we are undertaking the project. What benefit will someone get if this new product is in the world? What are our business objectives? Why should we spend money on this project instead of some other one? I like to capture that information in a vision and scope document, which serves as a container for the business requirements. All projects need some kind of a strategic guiding document like this. They might not call it a vision and scope document. Sometimes people create a project charter for this purpose. And in the commercial world, people often discuss a market or marketing requirements document. The business requirements get all project stakeholders aligned in the same direction, but they don't provide sufficient detail for developers to know what to build. Therefore, we need to go down to the second level of requirements, the user requirements. User requirements are a kind of what information. Just as business requirements explained why to undertake a project, user requirements answer the question, what will the user be able to do with the system? For many, but not all, types of projects, use cases are a good way to have this conversation about user requirements. A use case is simply a task or a goal that users need to accomplish with the help of the product. There are two schools of thought on use cases. One school says the use cases are the functional requirements. That's what you give to developers. However, I've never met someone who said that this method worked for them. Instead, many requirements analysts have told me that they gave their use case descriptions to the developers, and the developers got the general idea, but the use cases simply didn't provide enough information. As a result, the developers had to track down a lot of additional information so they knew just what to build. I generally employ use cases as a tool to help reveal the functional requirements. So our third level of requirements detail is the functional requirements. You don't implement business requirements. You don't implement use cases or product features. Developers implement specific bits of functionality. And if you implement the right set of functionality, then people can perform the use cases that are important to them. So the functional requirements that you need to implement are those that will let users get their jobs done. In Module 9, I will talk more about the use case technique and how to derive functional requirements from the use case descriptions. To reiterate, business requirements are a kind of why information. Why are we undertaking this project? User requirements are a kind of what information. What will the user be able to do with the product? And you probably think I'm going to say how, but you would be wrong. Functional requirements are another kind of what information. What does the developer build? I like to collect the functional requirements, along with a lot of other information, in a Software Requirements Specification, or SRS. So these three documents, Vision and Scope, Use Cases, and Software Requirements Specification, are the three containers for different kinds of requirements information. Now, they don't have to be three separate documents. On a small project, it would be ridiculous to create a lot of separate requirements documents. But they do contain different kinds of information, which comes from different sources at various stages of the project. The fact that the arrows between these requirement levels are aligned is not an accident. If you implement the right set of functional requirements, then users can accomplish their important business tasks, and the project will hopefully achieve its business objectives. Continuing with the model, sometimes people define the top-level requirements for a complex system. In this case, I'm not talking about a system as being any old information system. Instead, I'm referring to a system as a product that is made up of multiple subsystems. You'll see a good example of this type of system the next time you're in a supermarket. Look at all the stuff around the cashier's workstation. There's a scale, which is usually integrated with a barcode scanner. There's a keyboard and usually two displays, one for the cashier and one for the customer. There might be a card reader for your debit or credit card, and often there's a change dispenser. There are at least one, often two, and occasionally three printers for your receipt, your credit card charge slip, and some coupons you don't care about. And these components are all working together, It's a good example of a system. So sometimes the requirements for the product or the system as a whole, then, lead to functionality that's going to be incorporated into one or another of those subcomponents. People sometimes describe system requirements in terms of product features, so these are sometimes called product requirements. So far, we've been discussing the functional aspect of requirements, but we must also consider non-functional requirements. One aspect of these are business rules. Business rules are things like corporate policies, industry standards, government regulations, and computational algorithms. For example, consider the information system security policies in your organization. Companies often have policies such as how frequently you must change your logon password, the minimum and maximum length of a password, allowed and disallowed characters, and so on. Maybe a user can't reuse any of their last 10 passwords. These are examples of business rules. In Module 8, I will talk more about business rules and show you how certain business rules imply the need to implement specific functionality to enforce or comply with those rules. Quality attributes are often called the ilities. They include usability, portability, maintainability, availability, and many others. They don't all end in ility, such as integrity, efficiency, and robustness. Such requirements are also called quality factors or quality of service requirements. Performance is another example of a quality attribute. These kinds of non-functional requirements describe how well the product does something, not specifically what it does. In my experience, very few projects do a good job of specifying their quality requirements. Therefore, Module 8 of this course will describe quality attributes and other non-functional requirements and show several examples of how to specify them in a precise and verifiable fashion. We also need to specify requirements for external interfaces, connections between your system and the rest of the world, and then we have these design and implementation constraints. So you can see that the skilled requirements analyst must be able to communicate a variety of different requirements information,